So we are primarily a prayer group called the Fellowship that started in 1935, give or take, by the same guy who started the National Prayer Breakfast, a Norwegian named Abram Vrede, who went on to start the Goodwill Industries and some other things. Amazing guy. And all those years been faithfully meeting every Thursday since the mid-1930s. And we were praying for Seattle when they had, you know, more bars than churches. And the word Skid Row came out of Seattle, and the Depression and all those times, and all over the years, different things to pray for here. What's been interesting, what God's done in the last 2 years, is we've been meeting here in Zoom, except for our first time out. As I mentioned, before we formally started, we met Harvey Drake's church, Emerald City Bible Fellowship, and we're going to keep meeting maybe once a quarter live now. But what the Zoom meeting has allowed us to do is just break all these geographical limitations, and we still pray for Seattle, but praying for all of God's kingdom. And we had this theme this year of going out two by two, as Jesus told the 70 to go out and tell everyone about the kingdom of God is here, it's in your midst, and to do good things, heal people, cast out demons, call people to repentance. And the other thing is seeing ourselves as the body of Christ and all the different parts and different places doing our own little things, which all add up. So it's a beautiful thing to see all you guys here. We have an amazing chance, and I got to give some credit to George Tolles, who's made a lot of this happen the last few weeks. George had three guys on in the fall that we're still sort of reaping the fruits of that. Rod and Sherman and Dr. John Trent got together and talked about sort of the father's wound and the father's blessing and the need for all that. It was a powerful talk. And I've put that on our Facebook before. You guys can look that up on hisdeal.org. And so we're kind of reaping those fruits. And some of us have gone and watched the movie that Sherman is in, Show Us the Father, Show Me the Father. And again, very powerful, powerful film on family issues, generational issues, how, you know, we get wounded and trauma gets passed on, but it's also possible to write a new story, you know, and pass on a blessing to your kids or even people who aren't your kids. And you all know you've gotten blessed by different teachers and coaches and mentors. And that's another thing. The fellowship's always been about being intergenerational. We are also, of course, non-denominational and nonpartisan, just want to work for the good of the city and the country and the world. So Sherman Smith, I probably don't even need to say much more. He came here, played for the Seahawks, grew up in Ohio, played for a few teams, coached even much longer. And if you watch the movie, you'll see everyone he coached said he was more than a coach, but treated them like a son. He was a father figure. Talked about responsibility. If you have the ball, don't drop the ball, right? That's a great phrase. Do your part. And as we say in soccer, in a beautiful game, if you're off the ball, you have a role to play too. So there's always something for you to do. I'm not going to give all his story. I'm going to let Sherman talk to us. And maybe about 10 of 8, we'll come together and everyone can have a chance to ask questions and have open discussion. So real quick, Sherman, before you start, I think we've got a couple of new folks. Skip Hill, Glenn Nash, have you guys been here before?
No, this is Glenn, and I am connected with Rod Handley here in Lee Summit, Blue Springs, Missouri, so.
Awesome. Welcome. Glad to have you. It seems like Rod is a real evangelist.
Yeah. And Skip Hill is with us too. Skip's one of my guys as well, and just a wonderful friend. And we're strategizing right now with his church, Colonial Presbyterian, on how we can integrate Show Me the Father into an entire weekend retreat. So we're all ears on Sherman, any ideas you got on that, but we'll save that for our questions later.
All right. And just real quick invite, if you guys want to, we send out a weekly email saying, you know, what's going on and who's coming next. If you want to get on that, just put your email in the chat and we'll pick it up, put you on our list. All right, Sherman, take it away. Glad you're here, brother.
All right. Good morning, everyone. Some we have some people on the East Coast, and for my friends in the, on the West Coast, I noticed, you know, what is this, 7:18 out there? So you guys hang in there, you know. But thanks for allowing me to be a part of what you're doing. Thank you for the invitation, Vince. Thank you, Rod, for last week. Really enjoyed and got a lot out of what you talked about. I thought it was really interesting, you know, Rod, as you were talking last week, you were talking about how when you would be invited to speak somewhere and they say whatever's on your heart, and your message always came around accountability. And I was thinking about that, you know, how you were talking about accountability, and how for me, the last few years when I've been going out speaking, and they would say, hey, you know, whatever's on your heart, and you'll hear later on as I tell my story, the thing that I was always talking about was identity, our identity in Christ, how that was important to me. And I think you'll find out later on why that was so important to me. So I just want to thank you as I listen to your testimony, and I say I can understand where you're coming from. So, you know, yeah, and just talking about the story, talking about Show Me the Father, you know, the first thing I'll talk about to me is, you know, as a coach, whenever we got, you know, trying to get our guys ready, we spent 90% of our time, honestly, as coaches, getting our guys ready mentally. It was more the mental preparation than it was the physical preparation. And I think about, for those of you in, out there, Seahawks fans, this really hit me real hard. A couple years ago, I was watching a Thursday night game, and Bobby Wagner was mic'd up for that game. And you know, when they put the mic on them during the game, you get to hear what's happening in the huddle, you know, on the field, on the sideline. So you get some other perspectives as you get to hear these guys. And they were playing the Los Angeles Rams, and they were getting ready to go out on the field in the end of the game in the fourth quarter, and winning and losing was dependent on what the defense did. I think the defense had to stop them. They couldn't even get a field goal. And, you know, so here it was. So they knew what was on the line. And so what happened was Bobby Wagner was standing with his back to the field facing the defense as they were getting ready to go out there. And I remember what he said as they had him mic'd up. He yelled back to his teammates, get your minds right. Get your minds right. And I thought about that, how that pertains to us as believers, how we have to get our minds right, how we understand what's at stake, you know, what we need to do, you know, as we leave our home, as we go to work, as we're on our jobs, as we're mother and father and whatever we're doing, there's a thing that God is saying to us, get your minds right. And when you think about in Romans chapter 8, verse 5 and 6, where Paul says, for those who live according to the flesh, he said, they set their minds on the things of the flesh. And those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. He goes on to say, for the mind set on the flesh is death, but the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace. He says that the mind set on the flesh is opposed to God because it does not submit to God, because it's not able to do so. Then he says, for those who are in the flesh cannot please God. The things that really hit me on that as I just come to you this morning is, it's a mindset. We have to set our minds, as Paul is telling us in Romans 8:5 and 6, that if we live to please ourselves, that's a mindset. And as we live to please God, that is a mindset that we must set our minds each and every day. And so what I would say to you as we get ready to get into this, that if you know how to set the alarm on your phone, on your cell phone, then you know how to set your mind. You know the critical attributes that it takes to set your mind. First of all, I don't know what kind of phone you got. I have an iPhone. Maybe your phone's different than mine. Your phone may do some things that my phone won't do. But my phone, whenever I set the alarm on it, I must intentionally set my alarm. I must go in my phone and I must intentionally set the alarm. So it has to be intentional, like Paul is saying in Romans 8, 5 and 6. The next thing I know that I have to do, I have to be specific about the time that I want to set it to. My phone doesn't read my mind and just say, yeah, you know, set it at 6 o'clock, 8 o'clock, whatever it is. I must go in there and specifically set my phone to the time that I want it to go off. And then the thing I know is my phone, I must continually set. You know, if I wanted to go, it went off at 6:30 this morning, I have to go back in and set it again for it to go off at 6:30 tomorrow. So if your phone do something different, let me know after this and I might get me a different phone. But you know, but so that's what we got to do. So our minds, we have to, it's intentional, it's specific, and also it's continued, just like God told us. You know, and I think it's Colossians 3:1-4, where he says, since you're in Christ, set your heart on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things below. So the things that I want to do is just encourage us this morning to understand how important it is that we have to set our minds. It's intentional, it is specific, and it's continual. Romans 12:2, you know, don't be conformed to this world, but transformed by the renewing of your mind. We must continually renew our mind, set our mind. So I just want to encourage us along those aspects this morning. So sometimes we have to get rid of that stinking thinking. So, you know, as we get into this story, you know, show me the Father, you know, I'm going to share my testimony. We'll just talk about how, you know, how we just have to, you know, set our minds in this story on show me the Father, how it really began for me. You know, I'm blessed, man. My dad was my hero. My dad was absolutely my hero. Growing up in Youngstown, during a time when our country was going through a lot of racial tension, you know, my dad was my hero. I was fortunate that I didn't have to look outside the four walls of my home to see a man. That my father was all the man that I wanted to be. And I get so, you know, my dad passed away in 2009, and when people would say to me, boy, you look just like your dad. And I say, I hope you're talking about more than just a physical resemblance. I hope there's a resemblance of the character and the type of dad that my father was. And so my dad played an important role in my life. As we talk about getting rid of this stinking thinking, my father came to me when I was a junior in high school, and he said to me, son, what do you want to do when you graduate from high school? And I had a great plan. I just want to tell you, I had this great plan. Like, growing up in Youngstown, like I said, during the times of, you know, heck, the Civil Rights Bill wasn't signed until 64, so it was about 7 years after that bill was signed. So you can understand some of the things that happened in my community. So I gave my father my plan. I said, Dad, when I graduate from high school, I want to get a job in the steel mill. And I want to work there, Dad, like you worked for 32 years. And Dad, I want to live in the apartment complex right down the street from us. It's about 10 minutes from our home. I can be close to you and Mom. And that apartment complex down the street from us was a public housing unit called the Kimmelbrooks. And I said, Dad, and if I can get a nice car, that's all I want to do. I just want to have a dependable car that I can get around. I can get to work and I can get around in. And I can tell my father didn't like my plan. My father told me to get my coat because it was cold. He said, I want you to get your coat. We're going to go for a ride. And he told me, I don't want you to say a word. So we got in the car and we drove down by that apartment complex, the Kimmelbrooks, where I wanted to live. My dad said to me, son, don't buy the lie. Then we drove by another one of those apartment complexes, because there were three of them on the side of town where I lived, the McGuffey Terrace. And I mean, in these places, McGuffey Terrace and the Kimmel Brooks, I had friends that lived there, teammates. I went and hung out in those areas. That's why, man, I'm going to go hang out, you know. So, Dad, so he drives me by the McGuffey Terrace, and he says, son, don't buy the lie. And as we're leaving on the east side of Youngstown, and we're driving, getting ready to go someplace else, we drive by another one of those apartment complexes, and the name of it was the Plaza View Apartments, another public housing unit. My dad said, son, don't buy the lie. He said, don't buy the lie that this is the only place where you can live. And we drove over into Boardman, Ohio. At that time, I called it the high rent district, the vanilla suburbs, three-car garages, manicured lawns, and all that. My dad said, son, don't buy the lie that one day you can't live in a house like this. And after we went there, we drove to that steel mill where my dad worked. And I used to get excited when we would go pick him up from work, where my dad would, because it was underground, where he would walk up. They had to walk, but I would see my dad coming down the stairway. And he said, son, don't buy the lie that this is the only place where you can work. He said, son, don't buy the lie that you can't be a teacher, doctor, lawyer. My dad went through a whole list of things that I could do. And even back in 1971, and not being political, in 1971, my father said to me, son, don't buy the lie that one day you or another black man can't be president of the United States. That's why in 2008, when Barack Obama was elected, I remember when they announced it, I was in Virginia coaching with the Redskins, and I thought about what my dad said and how I was just overwhelmed with joy to see what he said come true. And like I said, man, it just spoke to me. And so my dad was such a difference maker in my life. As he told me, son, you can do better, you can be more. And how in that movie showed me the father, how it talked about passing the blessing on to my father, how my father didn't realize it, but how he was blessing me, how he was affirming me and encouraging me and telling me to go on. He was saying, son, don't buy the lie that was being sold to me, that was being perpetuated by racism, that was telling me as a young Black man that that's all I could hope to be. How those people outside of my community were telling me that I had no hope of any brighter future than living in the projects, working in the steel mill. And how also people inside of my community who had lost hope that was telling me that the best I could do was live in the projects and work in the steel mill. I thank God for my dad who told me, son, don't buy the lie. Don't buy the lie. And I thank God that because of my dad, I didn't buy the lie. So I go to school and I'm sitting there and in the classroom and my football coach is teaching a health class and I'm sitting in the back of the room. And all of a sudden, guys, I know, and ladies, I know that he was saying, God was speaking to my heart. And I said, man, Coach Knox, he had come to my high school about 4 years before. He had turned our high school around. At that point, our high school was one of the losingest high schools in the state. You know, I mean, we weren't winning football games. We were terrible. And he came and he turned that school and that community around on the inside out, because he talked to us about how we looked at ourselves, how we looked at each other, having pride in your community, pride in your school, pride in yourself, you know. And I understood the importance of, he was telling us how we looked at ourselves. We had to look at ourselves correctly because that would have an impact on how we looked at others. He said, if you don't look at yourself with value and with worth and with hope, you won't look at anyone else that with value and hope. So he changed our school and how we looked at each other. And I remember sitting there in that classroom, I said to myself, that's it. That's what I want to do. I want to be a coach. I want to make a difference in the lives of students and athletes, the way Coach Knox has made a difference in my life, as well as in the life of all my other teammates and my other classmates, because he had made a difference and impact in that school. And just talking to us about how we looked at ourselves, valuing yourself, and man, just the difference that he made. And I knew right then God was showing me what he wanted me to do. And God gave me the why he wanted me to do it, to make a difference. And later on, when I became a Christian, God gave me the how I was supposed to do it. So I thank God for Coach Knox, who was a father to me, just like I was to my players. You know, and when I went into coaching, one of the things that I would always say to my players was, you may not be looking for a father, but I'm going to treat you like you're my son. And I would encourage them in more things than just in football. You know, I was speaking to their life about other things, just like my dad was speaking to my life. And not only speak to them about those things, but speak to them the proper way. I talked to them with respect and with dignity, you know. So it's going to be the way I treated these guys, the way I talked to them. I'm going to treat you like you're my son. I'm going to talk to you the way that I would want somebody to talk to my son. I'm going to talk to you the way that I want somebody to talk to me. And so that was always my mindset, that the power of respect is to never disrespect. And so I was going to respect my guys. And so that's where I knew, man, I wanted to be a coach. And I knew why I wanted to coach. I was interviewed on a job by Lou Tepper, who was a strong Christian man at the time. He was the head coach at University of Illinois. And I remember the first question in this interview was, he said, why do you coach? Do you coach to make a living or do you coach to make a difference? And I knew that I knew the answer he probably wanted, but I knew his answer was my answer. And I can say to him in all honesty, I coached to make a difference. I coached to make a difference. And at that time, I had become a Christian. And I said, I coached to make a difference for the glory of God. I said, I don't look at coaching as my job. I look at it as my ministry. I see coaching as a ministry. And so that was my mindset as I went into coaching. So as I continue along the story, so my dad talks to me, man, don't buy the lie. You know, Coach Knox giving me a vision. Man, I want to be a coach. And then my mom, who was my shero in my life, you know, moms are important too. And my mom was my shero. So here it is. I had to get good grades in order to play football. So I had to get good grades. So I was offered a full scholarship to Miami University in Oxford, Ohio. And it's the cradle of coaches. So, man, I'm going to go to Miami of Ohio, cradle of coaches. And, you know, if you know anything about that school, at that time, Miami University was about 98.9% white. And, you know, the 1.1% minority students. So I knew the environment that I was going into. And my mom did, too. And my mom spoke in my life. My mom said to me as I got ready to go to college, got ready to go to campus, because she couldn't go with us because the car was packed full of my stuff. My mom said, son, you're getting ready to go to a place where people are going to say, not only, the only reason why you're there is because of affirmative action or because you're on a scholarship. And my mom said to me, son, don't be the one. My mom said to me, son, you're going to a place where people are going to say, not only can't you learn, you don't want to learn. She said, son, don't be the one. She said, son, you're getting ready to go to a school where people are going to say, not only can't you get along with others, you can't even get along with your own people. She said, son, don't be the one. She said, don't be the one they're talking about when they make that statement. She said, you have an opportunity to validate negative stereotypes and tear them down. You can make things better for those coming behind you, or you can make things worse. And so my mom was telling me right at that time, don't be the one. She was letting me know, not only did I have a privilege to go to college, but she was letting me know that I had a responsibility to make a difference, a responsibility to make things better for those coming behind me, So I thank God for my mom, and she gave me that valuable lesson about privilege and responsibility that I had of going to college. So I thank God for my mom telling me, don't be the one. And finally, the guy that spoke into my life, the guy that led me to Christ, Ken Hutchinson. You know, here it is. It's interesting, the title of this movie, Show Me the Father. Because when I was in college, people, I wanted to know who Christ was. I really did. But I had all these people telling me what Jesus could do in my life, but it didn't seem like he was making much of a difference in their life. I'm a visual learner. And the difference, the only difference I saw in the people that were talking to me about Jesus Christ, the only difference I saw between them and me was is that they went to church on Sunday more than I did. The only difference I saw between them and me was is that they went to Bible studies more than I did. I didn't see any difference in their life. They talked like I talked, walked like I walked, thought like I thought, and it was a confusing message to me. And one night I was walking back to my dorm when I was in college, and I looked up in the sky, and it was a clear night, and stars were in the sky. And I remember I said this, and this was in 1975. I looked up and I said, God, I need somebody to show me. I need somebody to show me who you are. I need someone to show me. And I know that God answered my prayer, because in 76, I was drafted by the Seattle Seahawks. And I'm sitting in the lunchroom at Eastern Washington University as a Seahawk. And I'm sitting in there. I was a quarterback in college, drafted as a wide receiver. And the day before training camp started, Jack Patera came to me and told me that they were going to move me to running back. They were going to make me a running back. And here it was, I'm in an NFL camp. I hadn't played running back since Little League football. And he's telling me I'm going to be a running back, you know, and oh my goodness. So I'm sitting in this lunchroom and I'm thinking, I have my degree. I just want to be a coach. Maybe it's time for me to cut and go back to Youngstown and just start coaching. So I'm sitting there and all of these guys are walking in. And now I'm hoping that all of these big guys, I sure hope they're offensive linemen, you know. Man, I sure hope that guy's an offensive lineman. And so they're walking in there, and this big black guy walks by me, big old chest, big arms, and he walks by me. And on the back of this T-shirt, it said, Hutch is going to Seattle to do God's battle. And I remember sitting in there getting somewhat angry, saying, here it is. I've come some almost 2,000 miles to run into another one of these so-called Christians. And I know at that moment, God put it on my heart. Watch him. Watch his life. And that's exactly what I did. I watched his life. And there was something different about this guy, something different about the way he carried himself. I could tell him, I knew he was a Christian. He wasn't thumping me over the head with the Bible, but just the way he loved me, the way he was loving on others, the way he talked, there was just something different about this guy. And we became good friends. At that time, we had 6 preseason games. And in our last preseason game, in the fourth quarter, Hutch was, he was a middle linebacker. He was clipped from behind, and he suffered a career-ending injury. I remember Hutch was on the field, laying on the field, crying in pain. My friend, this guy that was always laughing, joking, encouraging, man, all of a sudden he's in pain. They take him off the field, and the word comes back on the field that his career is over with. this injury will end his career. They said when they looked at his x-ray, it looked like his knee had exploded and his career was over with. All I could think about at that moment was, I want to hurry up and get in the locker room and console Hutch. I want to get in the locker room and be a friend to Hutch the way he's been to me. And I go into the locker room, and evidently that must have been on the mind of all my other teammates too. Because when I got to him in the locker room, there were all these people around him, man, patting him on the back and all that stuff. Hutch, you know, trying to encourage him. But I know right now, just like today is a spiritual appointment that we're keeping. We don't make spiritual appointments, we keep them. I knew then that God, I was keeping a spiritual appointment because the table's cleared. All of a sudden, it's just Hutch and I in that room. And he's sitting there, sitting on the table with ice packs on his knee and a smile on his face. And he says, Sherm, man, I'm excited. He said, Sherm, I'm excited to see what God has planned for my life. And I remember looking at him saying, man, you know, my friend must be on, they give him a lot of morphine or something. Man, this cat's on something, man. Because I know if that were me sitting on that table, I wouldn't be telling you about how excited I am about God. And I said, you can't fake this. This has got to be for real. And he just said, Sherm, man, I'm just excited to see what God has planned for my life. And right there in that locker room, I said, please tell me more about Jesus Christ. Right there in that locker room. And he shared the gospel with me right there. And I didn't accept Christ at that moment, but he shared the gospel with me. And I remember what he said to me. My dad said to me, don't buy the lie. Mom said to me, don't be the one. And Hutch, he said to me, Sherm, for the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. He said, man, don't be a fool. And he shared the gospel with me. And man, I thank God for that giant in my life. It's like the Luke 19 story, how Zacchaeus wanted to see who Jesus was. And it says that people were getting in the way. And then Zacchaeus ran down and climbed up a sycamore tree. I needed a sycamore tree. And Hutch was my sycamore tree. He helped me to see Jesus. And so that's my story. So as I get into Show Me the Father, you know, and showing me the Father and God putting it on my heart and showing me to become a coach. And then when I became a Christian, God gave me the how I was supposed to do it for his glory. How, you know, that God has called us to be sycamore trees. And as fathers, we're sycamore trees. That all men, fathers, men, we are difference makers. I know in the sport of football, when I would look at film, I would always look at film and I was trying to find difference makers. The Marshawn Lynches, you know, the Eddie Jordans, you know, Russell Wilsons, you know, the guys, the Bobby Wagners, man, you want difference makers. But I realize now, I realize then as a coach that every guy that I coach, every man who was possibly going to be a husband or a father was a difference maker. He was a difference maker. And so as I looked at those guys, man, I looked at them, that's why I said, man, I'm not only, you may not be looking for a father, but I'm going to treat you like you are my sons. And that's what I'm going to do. And that was my mindset when it came to dealing with my players and being a father. Like I think someone said earlier, they don't have to be your son for you to treat them like they are your son. There are a lot of young men out there that, you know, you're having the impact that a father would have. And even though I had my father in my life and my father was there and he made a world of difference in my life, I recognized that I still had other men in my life that validated what my father taught me and showed me. And so I not only did I have my dad, but I had other men in my life that made a difference also. And so before I get into the part about Dylan and I, and as I was talking about Rod and his story about accountability, the reason why identity became a big word for me was, as I had started my Christian life, I became that which I despised. And Rod, I think you said something about this last week, man. I took the grace of God and I misused and misapplied the grace of God. It became a license to sin. It became my freedom, man. What? My sins are forgiven? Past, present, and future? Oh, you got to be kidding me. I got fire insurance. So, man, I'm going to go out. I'm going to have a good time. I'm going to live it up. And, you know, and so I misunderstood grace. And so my friend Ken Hutcherson came to my house one day. He called me up. He said, man, I'm going to come by and I want you to do me a favor. And I said, absolutely, man. So he drove to my house. I was living in Woodinville and he was living in Redmond at that time. So he drove to the house and he said, man, you know, so I want you to do me a favor. And at that time, it was just me and Sharon, my wife, and my two kids. And he's acting like I got a house full of people, and he's making sure nobody's listening. Hey, man, do me a favor. What? Yeah, Hutch, what you want me to do? He said, but do me a favor. Stop telling people you're a Christian. He said, you're making it tough on the rest of us who are living to make a difference for Christ. Hey, man, I heard something. And he goes around. He said, stop telling people you're a Christian. The name of Jesus Christ is being ridiculed because of you. I knew this guy loved me, and I knew he was telling the truth. I knew he was telling the truth, and I knew that he was coming to me from a position of love because I knew how he had loved me. I knew he loved the Lord, and I knew he loved me. But the thing that got me was is he looked at me, and I could see in his eyes, I could see anger and pain. I could see mixed emotions in his eyes when he asked me this question. He looked at me, and he said, don't you know who you are? Man, don't you know who you are? And he went on to talk to me about my new identity in Christ, who I was in Christ, who my daddy was. Man, don't you know who you are in Christ? That, man, you're a child of the King. And that makes a difference in your life. And so I'm not going to spend a lot of time getting on that part because I want to, you know, talk a little bit about demon. But that's another talk right there. But the aspect of who we are in Christ, how that made a difference for me, how I had to understand my identity in Christ made a difference in how I was supposed to live. And I really should have learned that from my dad, because growing up in Youngstown, when my brothers and I would get ready to go somewhere, my dad would always say to us, hey boy, and he loved to call us boy, hey boy, don't forget who you are. Don't forget your last name. Don't forget who your daddy is. I should have learned right there. My father was trying to let me know my identity was supposed to have an impact on my behavior. They talk about the king of Saudi Arabia. He went out one day with the prince. And you know, a prince is nothing but a king in waiting. And he went out one day with the prince, and the king was doing his business, talking to people. And the young prince kept slouching over in the chair. And the king would look over and say, son, sit up. He'd sit up for a few minutes, then he'd slouch over in the chair again. Dad would look over and say, son, I said, sit up. Boom. After a few minutes, he'd slouch over again. And the third time when the dad said to him, he said, son, sit up. He said, don't you know who you are? When we know who we are, it'll impact how you sit. It impacts your life. And God wants us to know who we are in Christ, that impacts our life. Tony Evans, in his study Bible, he has 15 essentials for spiritual growth. He says the number one essential for spiritual growth is conversion. That's being in Christ. He said the key to spiritual growth is identity, understanding who you are in Christ, because everything else, the what we are, the why we are, the how we are, comes from our identity in Christ, who we are. So I just thank God for that message of understanding identity. So as I talk about my relationship with my son, recognizing, realizing that when I got a call in November 2017 from this young man that I had recruited in high school, coached in college, maintained a relationship with throughout my life and his life, when he called me in November 2017, he said, I need to talk to you. I thought at that time he wanted to talk to me about his probably pursuing a job. You know, he was probably had an opportunity to get a coaching job somewhere. But when we started that conversation, it never went to football. He said to me, you know that I'm adopted? And I said, yes, I do. He said, you know, I started to look for my biological parents. And that's great. And he said, I got my birth record. Finally got my birth record. That's awesome, man. And I'm excited for him. And he said, I found my biological mom. Man, alike, man, this story, this is beautiful. Man, praise the Lord, you know, all that stuff. And then he told me his mother's name, and my heart sank, because I knew that I knew her in a manner in which, before it could set in for me to think it, he said it. He said, and I asked her who my father was, and she said, you. And man, it hit me like a ton of bricks. It's like a bomb went off. I'm glad I wasn't driving in my car somewhere. I'm glad that wasn't the case, because I guarantee, man, I'd have ran off the road. You know, I'm glad that the traffic wasn't going the other way. I might have drove right into somebody's car. You know, it hit me that hard. You know, and so he's telling me, and man, my ears are just, I almost can't hear anything else he's saying. You know, and so I said, man. So I'm listening to him. He said, so he's going through it. Hey, if you are my father, if you aren't my father, great. We have a relationship. If you are my father, that's great. We'll build on our relationship. I don't want anything from you. I'm not mad at you. None of that stuff. You know, you've been in my life and all this other stuff. But man, all I knew is, you know, I told him, I said, I need to call you back later. I need to process this. So I can tell you what happened to me is God took me through a period of grief, of grieving, because I had to grieve over my sin of being irresponsible and reckless when I was in high school, that this young man grew up and he didn't have what I had. He didn't have that father in his life like I had, that he missed out. And I hope that my kids would say that, man, the difference I made in my life, and because of my irresponsibility, this young man didn't have what I had. And God allowed me to go through a period of time where I grieved over my sin before he allowed me to experience the joy of his grace and how he had worked this, took this mess and made a miracle out of it. God allowed me to hurt. He did for a while before he allowed me to go to the experience and the grace of the joy of this new relationship, this newfound relationship. I think so many times we're so fast to run to the grace of the forgiveness instead of experiencing the grief of our sin and the price that Christ paid for our sins. And so, man, I just had to go through that. And I thank God for that. Before, and so what had happened, there was about a week period that, you know, I talked to Dylan and I said, let's get a DNA test. I had talked to Dylan's biological mom, who I hadn't talked to in 45 years, talked to her, you know, and I told her, you might be sure, but I want to be sure. So during that period of time where we're waiting for the DNA test to come back, it was during that time that God changed my heart. And I knew that, I'll be honest with you guys, at first, when it first started, I was hoping that I wasn't his father. And I was hoping that I wasn't his father because I wouldn't have to deal with the guilt of him not having a father in his life. I could get rid of that guilt. But boy, I tell you what, before the DNA test came back, I knew that I would have been disappointed if I wasn't his father. You know, that would have really disappointed me. And so my wife, she was excited. So we get the results back and we're all ecstatic about it. So, you know, so really that's kind of the basis of the story, you know, people. And so I know you may have questions on the story and other stuff about it, but you know, that's how for us, how we went through the grieving part, you know, how I was excited to find out I was his dad, how for him to say to me, you were in my life, you know, you just didn't know how much of a difference you made in my life, you know, how that spoke to me, how that gave me some comfort, you know, and then to see how other young men were impacted the same way Coach Knox impacted me. I wish I had a chance right now, and then Bench, we can get to questions, to talk to Coach Knox so I could say to him, thank you for the difference you made in my life, even though he knew my dad, you know, to be able to say thank you for the difference he made in my life, how he was a father to me and didn't know it also. And so you know, if you have any other questions about the story, my testimony and other things, you know, like I said, that thing about our identity in Christ, that is critical because there's about 8 or 9 things about that identity that will change your life if you think about it. And so, but I don't want to take up time on that, but just if there's any questions on this story or show me the Father, how we point people to our Heavenly Father, how we're imperfect as fathers, but we have a perfect Father in heaven and how it makes a difference. And how, I know you're telling the story, a guy that I work with called me, he and his wife watched the story this week. His wife, he said, Sharon, my wife has never been one that's been very motivated religiously to pray and all that other stuff. He said, she watched that story and she said to her husband, I want you to pray for our children. I want you to pray for our son-in-laws. I want you to pray a blessing on them, how it impacted her. And he said, man, how that impacted him. So I just know, you know, Rod, you had asked how this came about. Tony Evans said, God is going to use this story for his glory. In 2018, ESPN did a story on it called Identity. And then I said, man, that's not, you know, God's going to use it for something else. And then the Kendrick brothers, they got a hold of me and said, you know what? We'd like to use part of your story in our documentary. And at that time, I didn't know how much of the story they were going to use. I really didn't. You know, it could have been just a small snippet, but they used quite a bit of it as I first saw it. So that's how it got to where it got. The Kendrick brothers, Alex and Steven, you know, they reached out and those guys are awesome. to work with, man, you know, to be a part of a documentary that I know that they said they've been praying about for years that they prayed about this documentary, and they had the title of it years ago, Show Me the Father. And how that line, where I was walking back to my dorm, I said, God, I need somebody to show me. So how we all need someone to show us the Father. So any question you guys have, I'd love to answer your questions.
Before the questions come, let me say something, Sherman. My word of the year is identity. I had no idea that's what you were going to talk on here. So I'm just writing frantically as you're talking, because so many wonderful scriptures and nuggets you just gave us on identity and who we are. So thank you for,
yes.
Thank you for sharing that good word. Any, did you have any resistance to the movie to tell the story, or were you gung-ho from the day Tony Evans said that?
Well, here's what happened. It's interesting, Rod. When Dylan and I, that first day that, you know, I'm finding out we're going through this thing, hey, you're my dad, you know, we'll do a DNA test. Dylan is active on social media. So he asked me this question. He said, how do you want to handle this when this gets out? So remember, this is a fresh wound for me. For Dylan, he's excited that he just found his biological parents, his biological dad. His mom is excited. His biological mom, she's excited. This son that I put up for adoption 45 years ago, I made contact with him. I didn't know I had a son. You know, I wasn't looking for a son. So when I got that phone call, I wasn't excited. It wasn't a moment of celebration for me. It was a moment of shock. So Dylan said to me, how do you want to handle this when this gets out? So I said to him at that moment, I said, if it gets out, I said, man, this is a personal matter and a family matter. What do you mean when it gets out? So at that point, man, this is personal. This is family issue. This isn't, I wasn't getting ready to call the Tennessean and say, hey, guess what? I just found out I had a 45-year-old son. You know, that wasn't what I was getting ready to do. I was, man, I'm trying to process this myself. So Rod, God's timing of this was perfect, you know. So, because like I said, the ESPN thing came out before that. So God had prepped my heart before that. But if Stephen and Alex Kendrick had called me up that day and said, we want to do a documentary, I would have said, not right, not, no, you know. And it wasn't, for me, it wasn't embarrassment at all. That wasn't it at all, you know. I wasn't embarrassed about how it made me look. It was just, man, I need to deal with this, you know, and it was personal to me. This is a personal issue. And I didn't care what anyone thought except my wife and my two kids. And that's a whole nother story, how my wife handled it with grace, how she just encouraged me. And I mean, my wife, man, she didn't go through a processing period. My wife said, hey, our family just got bigger. I want to go meet my grandsons. And she has done everything to let Dylan know that he is loved and accepted by our whole family.
Awesome. Thanks for sharing your story, man. You said a number of things that I will be preaching on. So thank you for this material.
Okay.
God, you answered my question about Sharon's response to all of this, but how much time lapsed between the time you discovered that you had this son and the movie itself or the documentary?
It's probably, Harvey, it was probably, they started filming during the pandemic. So it was a couple years. Okay. But my attitude would have been, honestly, probably if they had contacted me, like I said, it was a week from when Dylan called me to a couple weeks, when Dylan called me when we got the DNA results. So I think by the time I got the DNA results, my heart was good. You know, hey, you know, wherever this goes. And that's when Tony Evans made that statement to me in November of 2017. God is going to use this story for his glory. And so, you know, I've been ready to go then if that would have been offered to me.
Thank you.
Hey, Sherman, Tony Evans also said a lot in that movie about adoption, like spiritual adoption. Oh. There's a lot of verses about adoption. And I know I wrote you, a lot of people here know my story about growing up with an adopted black brother. My mom adopted him in Illinois in an orphanage, 1971. His parents couldn't be together or keep him. And she has dementia. And some days, I don't know if she knows who I am, but I sat her down with me to watch a movie. And she just had tears streaming down her face. She was just blown away.
I bet. I tell people, you know, I got a lot out of that movie, you know, not the other stories. And the line that got me was Jim Daly at the end. You know, when he's down there in his basement, he's talking about how he's struggling. I got to make all these decisions. And God, I need a father. I need this. And where he says, God, you know, speaks to his heart. Haven't I been a good father to you? Man, I said, that's powerful right there. I think we can all attest to that. No matter what our situation is, God is saying, haven't I been a good father to you? You know, I think one of the greatest insults that we give to God is when we question his love for us. Does God really love me? Yeah, that should be unquestionable, undeniable, that how much he loves us, you know? And so, man, haven't I been a good father to you? So, man, that story right there speaks to a lot of people in a lot of different ways.
Hey, Sherman, I'm promoting the movie to everybody. I mean, I just think every guy see this thing. And I'm curious, have they developed any Bible study resources to go alongside with guys that want to take the next step, that want to, you know, be the kind of father they need to be? Is there something that has been developed by the Kendrick brothers? And if so, point us where we need to go.
Honestly, bro, I do not know what's going on with that aspect. You know, what Steven and Alex are doing with this, because, you know, they're involved in so many other things. And these guys, man, if you hear these guys speak, you know, the word of God just pours out of them. So I don't know if they tried to develop something from this. I just know, you know, people talk about mentoring and being a father. And all I know is, you know, I guess the only intentionality that I had out of it was like my father's intentionality. He was just in my life. It was just our relationship, you know. And I tell people when it comes to mentoring, like with Dylan and my players, honestly, I didn't look at a guy and say, man, I'm going to mentor that guy. I'm going to this, that. It was just, I want to have a relationship with the guy. You know, we're going, man, I'm like I have with my son. You know, I'm just going to have a relationship with him and just love him, you know, and that was it. And there was sometimes, man, there were some strong words and hard words that I had to say to some guys, you know, but they knew that I loved them as a father. So when I talk to guys about being, it's just, man, you know, surrounding yourself by godly men that have an idea what it takes, what it means to be a good father, but having a desire to just, man, love people, you know, just to love on them. And, you know, that's all I know. I said, man, nothing was intentional where I made someone my project, but it was just, I'm going to just share my life with them. Absolutely. And what comes out of it, you know, here's what's going, this is what comes out of it.
Well, the stories are plentiful, Sherman, as to guys that heard the message and are now applying it. I'm embarrassed. Jim Martin. Jim Martin has done 6 blessing ceremonies with kids and grandkids following this movie. Another guy in our ministry has done, I think he's done 6 or 7 himself. I mean, guys are understanding I have a role as a father and I need to be a blessing and so this motivated, inspired. We got dads that'll never live their life differently from here on out because of your faithfulness and your willingness to share your story. So thank you.
Well, thank you. It's been a blessing to me and an encouragement to all of us. You know, it encourages me. And even as I, you know, Rod had encouraged one of my players that called me up who's coaching. And he was telling me about his success as a coach. But then before he was telling me about his failure as a husband and as a father, you know, and just, man, you know, he said, you know, coach, I'm getting it done on the field. My teams are this. He said, but my marriage and my relationship with my kids is not great. I said, then you really haven't succeeded. You failed. Your number one assignment begins at home. You know, I would never want to be a guy that says, man, I've been a successful coach. And, you know, yeah, but along the way, there was some collateral damage. You know, I lost my wife, my kids. We don't have a relationship. And so what the important thing is putting first things first. That responsibility God has given us as husbands, as men. That's why I look at every guy, every young man and say, you are a difference maker. You, by gender, because you're a male, you have kingship in you. You have the ability to make a difference in those lives that God will put under your influence, beginning with your wife and your children. And that's where you, if you want to measure your success, you better start there. And the last thing I want to say, guys, on this identity part too, just saying, man, that identity, you know, where Hutch really hit me with, and I know Harvey, you talk about mad stuff, and just this identity thing. When he hit me, when he talked about that identity thing, you know, he just let me know. He said, man, you're living under new management because you're now living by faith. He said, man, you got new power because the Holy Spirit indwells you. He said, man, you got new freedom because you're no longer a slave to sin. You're a slave to righteousness. He says, man, he said, you got a new purpose. You now live to glorify God. Man, you got a new playbook. The Bible is now your instruction manual. You got a new mindset. You know, you think differently. You got new motivation. God's love and God's grace motivates you. So he was just going through and said, all of these things, because you're in Christ, man, you got new things in your life. And so I just think about that, how that makes a difference for us, understanding our identity.
Hey, tell me, Hutch is an amazing character in that movie, and he doesn't get a large part, but he comes out long. Some of the stuff you told us is not in the movie, but that's amazing stuff. We've had, in the last year, a number of people talk about the first conversion when they give their eternal life to Christ. Mm-hmm. But later in life, some point, a lot of people have said there comes a time there's a second conversion when they give their earthly life to Christ, right, and start living in a different way right here, right now. You know, right, it sounds here, like right, he called you out to that.
Well, yeah, because what happens when, I don't know about you, when I first came to Christian, became a Christian, they was talking about you need fire insurance. I was, you know, hey, man, you need fire insurance. And, you know, and I wanted to have the confidence that Hutch had. So I wanted Jesus as Savior, that Lord part, you know, he wasn't talking about that. I ain't got to that part yet, you know. So yeah, then, no, you know, I like how he says it. We have to believe the gospel to be saved, but we must also believe the gospel to live saved. And that's what I had to do. I said, man, I have to apply the gospel to live saved, not only just to be saved.
I would imagine that with all the young men you've had the opportunity to interact with, that your message is probably a life changer and a game changer, if I could use that phrase, because of the surrounding that they tend to grow up in, not affirmed, or they get the wrong message about what manhood is,
yes,
you know, the whole nine. So appreciate you being that solid witness to them, because people need an alternative to what they see all around them. The culture, yeah, is definitely trying to shape and form us into a certain thing. And unless they see that alternative, they don't know there's an alternative, which is what,
exactly,
your father did for you. He took you to those, yeah, places and, yeah, said, don't believe the lie. Don't believe the lie. He gave you an alternative perspective. And right, I think that's what the Christian life could be to a lot of people. They see what it means to do business well, what it means to raise a family well, what it means to interact with the opposite sex world, et cetera. So thank you for being that witness. And so I guess the question I would have following that statement is, how would you describe how the average young person on an average football responds to your type of message and model?
Yes.
The one thing I truly believe is this, if they don't like what they see, they're not going to believe what you say, mm-hmm, you know? And that's a Ken Hutcherson line that he used to say to us, what you do speaks so loud, I can't hear a word you're saying. And I know for me, I needed somebody to show me, man, show me that this is for real. You know, don't talk about it, be about it. That's, you hear those comments all the time. So that's the thing that I saw, Harvey, is that, man, people want you to show them. And it's not that you're perfect, because my players knew that I wasn't perfect. I shared my stuff with my players. And sometimes it was because of those failures that they came to me and we got to talk, because they know that I'm coming from a standpoint that I understand, I can relate. Hey, what helped you go from here to there? And I tell them, I said, man, I'm still getting there. You know, I'm just not, you know, my starting point, I'm just not at the starting line. I'm still running to the finish line. So I'm not, you know, so, but to me, it's living it. I think you got to live it. I think Paul said in Titus chapter 2, I think it's verse 6-8, where Paul is talking to Titus, and he says, encourage young men to be self-controlled. In everything, set them an example by doing what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness, and soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that those who oppose you will be ashamed because they have nothing evil to say about us. Mm. And Paul said, man, show them. Show them. You got to set an example. And I think that's what we have to do. When we mess up, we need to fess up. You know, we need to say, man, I'm not perfect. You know, one thing that I didn't have to do when the story came out about, you know, when I had to tell my kids about this son that I had, it was 45 years old. I didn't have to apologize to him and say, well, I know I told you growing up that I was this choir boy and I lived this life, man. And I did all this stuff right. I didn't have to do that with him. You know, they knew my history. They knew that dad's feet are made of clay. And this was part of the deal. What was funny somewhat when I told my daughter laughed. She said, well, do you have any more kids out there? You know, she wanted to know, you know, you gonna get any more phone calls? I said, I hope not, because I'm going to hang up the phone the next time somebody called. But my daughter knew, said, Dad, you know, you said you were out there a little bit. So here it is, the word of God coming back. Don't be deceived. God's not going to be mocked. He's going to reap what you sow, you know. So you reap what you sow more than you sow and later than you sow. So God, so there was some reaping and sowing. So, but I think we got to show him, man. We got to show him and be honest with him. I think that is really important, to be vulnerable. To make, you got to be vulnerable and say, hey, I'm not perfect. You know, I'm going to tell you and share this with you guys too, real quick. Marshawn Lynch, you guys, everybody know about Beast Mode. That's my guy, man. Coaching that guy for 7 years or 6 years was, man, you want to talk about a pleasure in my life. You know, coach, 7 years. Coaching Marshawn for 7 years was a pleasure in my life, you know. And so what we would do on Fridays, the week of a game, there was time before we had time on that day when I would go into my individual meetings, you had a little extra time. So what I would do, I would start every Friday off, we'd have a devotion. Because these guys allowed me to speak to them as sons, they wanted me to share. I could share with them. And I had other Christians in that room. I had other Christian players. So we would take turns. Hey, man, who's going to do it this week? Justin Forsett said, hey, I got it this week. Another guy would say, I got it. So what happened, we were doing this. We did this about 5 or 6 weeks in a row. And something happened where Daryl Bevel said, hey, Sherm, you guys need to, I need the running backs to stay in here a little bit longer. So we didn't have time to do this. So we go probably about 3 or 4 weeks without doing these devotionals. Now, during these devotionals, Marshawn would never say anything. He would just sit there and listen. 3 or 4 weeks goes by and he stopped me. And he'd always call me Big Dog. Hey, Big Dog, boss man. You know, he said, when are we going to get back to having our time in the morning on Fridays? Mm-hmm. He said, I miss that. He said, you might not think I'm listening. He said, but I am. He said, I want you to know I miss hearing that, you know, during that time. So, man, I just said, man, that's, people are listening. Guys are listening. You know, they want to hear.
Hey, Sherman, yesterday I got a hold, Kerry Casey and I had a long talk. I found out you guys got a little history too. And his son, yeah, Marcellus, is the chaplain for the Chiefs. And so we're strategizing right now here in Kansas City, especially with Dylan's got a Super Bowl ring. We got history. Yeah. We got to figure out how to show this to the players, because there's some very public father wound stories that have emerged. And I just think what a healing that this movie could be for Marcellus, to bring that right in the locker room and to share it with the men and the women there, because it's a game changer.
I heard that the quarterback, good grief, I'm trying to think, the quarterback for Minnesota Vikings, he's a strong Christian. Oh, man, can't think of his name right now.
Kirk Cousins,
that they showed it to their team.
Beautiful.
Right, that's the word I got, that they showed it to the entire Viking team organization.
Well, we want the same for the Chiefs, and Patrick Mahomes is a very strong man of faith, and I think Patrick would love to see this in the locker room for the guys. Yep.
Well, Dylan left and went to Indiana University, and they showed it to their entire football team. They sat in the auditorium and watched. So, you know, it's getting out there, showing it. Teams are seeing it. So I hope the Chiefs get to see it also.
Absolutely.
I'm wondering, Sherman, I guess I should say that Hutch had an impact on my life as well. In fact, Urban Impact, the organization and ministry that I was that I founded in 87, was because of Hutch.
Well, Harvey, you know, and you know what? It's interesting, Harvey, blame it on my head, not on my heart. When I saw you get on there, I saw you now, I said, we've had contact somewhere before.
Oh, yeah.
I said, you know, the name wasn't, but I saw your name. I said, that name is very familiar to me. So like blame it on my head, not my heart, you know.
Yeah, yeah, Dave Brown and Eugene Robinson, they would have me do chaplains, have me do devotions for the Seahawks when they were kind of in the club way back when. So go back a little ways.
Yes,
and I did worship over at the church for about a 6-month period, my wife and I, way back when.
Okay, see, I knew
there was some... Incredible, man.
Yes.
Yeah. So, the other question I have is, you have siblings, I'm assuming, and wondering what impact did your father have the same impact on your siblings as on you?
Yeah, you know, I have an older brother, and my younger brother just passed away with cancer in 2017. And it really, what's interesting for both of my brothers, my younger brother, my older brother, they have the story of their wilderness experience, where my older brother ended up in jail. He had a drug issue, ended up in jail. My younger brother, same situation. He didn't end up in jail, but he had a drug situation also. And so, you know, so here it is. So my older brother tells a story how he's sitting in jail in Atlanta, in Georgia somewhere. And he wakes, and my older brother is the first one that told me about Christ, my older brother. When I was in college, my older brother, he got caught up in one of these Pentecostal churches. So, I mean, you want to talk about, he was on fire. I mean, he was, so whatever happened to him. And so he's sitting in jail, and he said, he wakes up one day and he says, you know what? I grew up in the same house as Sherman and Daryl, you know, same father, you know, and I had the same influence. I just made different decisions than what they made, but he knew what to do. He just wasn't doing it. You know, he said, Dad taught me just like he taught Sherman. And then my younger brother, before he passed away, you know, he talked about his life also. And he said, you know what, man? I made bad decisions. I was taught the right things, you know, but I made different decisions, you know? So my dad, he impacted all of us. We all saw it. We responded to it differently and later, but we all recognized, you know, that our father had an impact on us, and we weren't living up to our true, what we knew to be the truth in a lot of cases.
Alan, I see you got your hand up. Go ahead. And then we'll have a closing prayer. Maybe Harvey, hang on for that. And we'll have continue a little informal conversation after that.
Can you guys hear me? Can you hear me?
Now we can.
Okay. I just couldn't share. Sherman, I just want to say thanks. I mean, I think we're similar ages. Did you get out of college in 1976?
Yes.
Okay, same as me. And so I was following Jim Zorn and Large and all the guys that were coming to Seattle, and it was pretty exciting stuff. But just listening to all the things you shared, and I have a whole page of notes here, my friend. For most of us, with the exception of Adele and maybe one others, are fathers in this room. I mean, I'm looking at fathers, all right?
Mm-hmm.
And all your comments hit us in a good way and in a challenging way in some place in my life, some place in your life. I know they will. Every one of us is reflecting on our own sons, our own daughters, mm-hmm. how we've done. That's what's going through our mind as we're listening to you today. And so I just wanted to say thank you. I mean, we get to be a father for life. It's so wonderful. I mean, never stopped being a father. Now I'm a grandfather and the joy of all that. But it's just, I just want to say, because of all that you've shared, that it challenges us in a good way to just be thinking more intentionally about the joy of being a father, even when we make mistakes. And I'm the first one to say that I've made them. Boy, have I made them. But it's never, ever too late to go back to try to reconcile if it's needed, whatever the case may be.
That's right.
So I'm reaching out to my son who lives in Portland, Oregon, right after this meeting and having a nice chat with him.
Yeah.
Our relationship is good. It's not perfect. It's good, but I'd love for it to be better. So I just wanted to say thank you. And what are you doing today? I mean, if someone says, Sherman, here you are. It's just February of 2022. What's the Lord got you doing today?
Alan, really doing a lot of like what I'm having an opportunity to do today with you guys, you mm-hmm. know, and sometimes it's more in a personal, you know, in person, you know, at churches or, you know, God allows me to speak he's opened the door where I can go speak it to football teams and, you know, just different situations like that. So he's given me an opportunity to share the message, you know, so, so I thank God for that, you know. And I tell you, Alan, just like you said, with your sons, and I said to mine, you know, my son had his 40th birthday on February 1st. And like you said, man, we know we're not perfect and they know we're not perfect. So, you know, we might as well go ahead and fess up to it because they know it already. So yeah. I was commenting to my son about, you know, how proud I am of you, the type of man you are, the type of father you are and all the other stuff. And I said, man, and you're a good student. I said, because as you watched me, you learned what not to do.
And what not to do.
Yeah. You learned a lot of that, you know. Yeah. I said, so I'm glad that you were able to pick out the bones to eat the meat, you know.
Well, because I'll share this one and then I don't want to, then I'll be quiet. But yeah, you are so right that they watch because the good Lord, and it was all because of him, he allowed me to stop drinking overnight 11 years ago, overnight. Wow. And my son was living at home then. He was 20 years old. He was 20 years old 11 years ago. And he watched what happened in me. And he told me about a year later, he said, Dad, I watched what you did. And I'm so grateful for that. And because of that, he stopped smoking marijuana. He says, I stopped smoking marijuana because I saw what you did with the alcohol. It just touches me. So yeah, they're watching. Yeah, they are watching all the time.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, just like we're doing, you know, and that's why I try to encourage, even as I encourage believers, there are a lot of people like in that Luke 19, a lot of people like Zacchaeus that want to see Jesus. And the people that are getting in the way are not non-Christians. They're the people that go to church and people say, here's what Jesus can do. So people are looking at us, you know, and they're saying, you know, man, like I said, if they don't like what they see, they're not going to believe what we say, you know? So, you know, man, we got to live. It's interesting how in the gospel in John, from John 13 to John 17, Jesus know he's getting ready to die. And the two most important things that he talks about at the end of those four chapters, he's talking about loving and being one in unity. Right. He said, man, here's how they're going to know you're my disciples, how you love one another. You know, he prayed, Father, I pray that they're one as we're one, you know. So the world is looking at how we love people and how we're together. So, you know, we just live it. And, you know, that's all we can do is just live it and trust God.
Sherman, do you know a Marvin Charles in Seattle and Dad's, his ministry called Dad's Marvin Charles?
See, I've heard of the ministry.
But you've not met him, Marvin?
I have not met
him. I'll connect you guys. You guys will have a whole lot to share with each other. He's a phenomenal
guy. That'd be great.
And he's come to this group several times over the years.
Cool. Anyway, that'd be
I'll
great.
I'll do that offline. Thank you.
I appreciate
you today.
Okay.
Just for time, and I know some people had to leave already. We generally have a closing prayer about now, but then people hang on and chat for a little longer. I did, Alan, you made me want to ask one thing. If you guys have a short statement, I do see we have two mothers on here still. What are your thoughts? How do you react to all this, Father? What do you hear out of what Sherman's saying? If you want to, Adele, Elisa.
I know Elisa is on a another call right now. I think she stayed right on, but
all right, Adele.
You know, a long time ago, I read this book by James Dobson when my kids were little, and I think it was Bringing Up Boys, the title of it, and it was so powerful to me because it was talking about how Hallmark brought in to prison. It was on Mother's Day. They brought in Hallmark cards and they were just flooded with this opportunity to send out cards, and everybody wanted to send cards to their moms. Just everybody in prison was sending cards to their moms. They just couldn't wait to send cards to their moms. And so they brought it in again on Father's Day. And nobody in prison wanted to send them to their dad. And I put the book down and I literally wept. I wept. And I thought, I can get my kids to love me so much. But if I don't build the strongest relationship with their dad, it will be in vain. My job is to build the strongest bridge possible with their dad. Because their love for me can build a bridge right to prison.
Right.
They gotta love their dad. Like that bridge is, and now they're in their, you know, they're all adults. My son turned 18 this year. And guess what? They all call their dad. Like I feel a little bit invisible in their lives. They like need their dad right now. They are like, dad, dad, hey, how do I, dad? Like they need their dad so much as adults. Like it is so dad driven. They need their mama when they're young. Like they, it is so mom driven when they're young. Like, but boy, when they're 18 and older, it is so dad. Like right. Dad, how do I do this? Dad, how do I, it is so life skill, dad life. So
yeah.
I feel very like, like, yay. I'm so like, my husband is incredibly involved in their lives now. And I'm a little bit like, I am so glad to be partnered with him. And he's like, I'm like, remember me here. I'm part of, you know, like, and I'm like, I'm so glad I have him because at least he loves me still. Yay. So that's how I feel. I'm glad to be here. I'm glad he still loves me. So, I don't know.
That's my impression. The cards will keep flowing.
Yeah. Dads are incredibly important. Yes. Amen. Right. And wives better, like, sometimes we just got to shut our traps and stop, like, support our husbands, like, yikes alive. Like that's
good. You know,
Adele, you had that in you. I think I've heard you say that before. Thanks, Adele, for sharing. Go ahead, Sherman.
I was just thinking, Adele, what you said, you know, I think about even when, you know, when Sharon and I start first having our kids, it's interesting. I'm trying to think how you said it, because it seemed like at the beginning, you know, and when they're young, it's all about mommy, you know, and I can understand that, you know, but as I see, as they get older, you know, as they got older, it was more, like you say, it was that dad thing, that connection that was really, you know, that became even more important. And my role increased in a lot of different ways when they became older. When I say older, I'm not saying when they turned 25, but just how that progressed, you know, into, you know, the mom thing. And like you did with your husband, my wife affirmed me tremendously with our kids. And so now our relationship is great because, you know, mom did a great job of affirming my importance, even during the times when mom was the one that was, they were asking for mom more than they were asking for me, you know.
Well, we don't have grandbabies yet. So maybe when that happens, they'll be mom. You know, like, maybe I'll get
important. I'll be back.
I don't know.
They'll be like, back.
Oh, from this ebb and flow.
Well, they haven't gone anyway. I know, yeah. My kids, they asked a story about, like, when I had to tell my kids about, you know, dealing about my son that I found out I had. The first question from my daughter and my son, the first thing out of their mouth was, how is mom? How is mom? They wanted to know about their mother. How is she doing? You know, and when I told her she was fine, that your mom is fine, they were fine. So mom is huge.
You know? Still huge. And always.
As always, Adele. So I thank you for affirming your husband and you know, in the relationship you have with him and that he still loves you.
Dr. Dobson told me I better do it. Like, I mean, sometimes, like you said, sometimes these things just have to be set. You just got to do them. Whether you feel it or not, they just have to be a mindset to do it.
That's right.
They just have to.
Well, I know one thing we say, one thing that's necessary in a celebration, I don't think just in manhood, but in adulthood, that there has to be a lion and a lamb in everyone. And the art is to be both and know when to be which.
Yes.
And I give my father credit for that, that my father was really good. He was a balance of lion and lamb. And he would shock me. The times I thought he was going to be a lion, he was a lamb. And when I thought I was going to get the lamb, I got the lion. You know, but there was such a balance. And I remember asking my kids that. I said, hey, how'd you see me? And they said, Dad, you were balanced. You know, there were times when you had to, you know, you had to give it to them. it might hurt you, but I'm gonna tell you, and there's times, you know, there's that tender part that comes out. So yes, tell the truth.
That is good. I'm gonna remember that. I've never heard that. That is truth I'm taking with me.
Okay.
So good.
Also, so I want to thank you, Sherman. You guys might not notice. I won't ask him to say anything, but my son's on here. Noah's iPhone. And so, you know, sometimes you notice as a coach, you can't do everything as a parent either. And even when they were younger, sometimes I'd bring them to somebody else and say, you talk to them. And, you know, prophet in his own land, mm-hmm. sometimes they hear it from somebody else better. Yeah. You know, we need right. other men in their lives. So I'm glad he got to hear you this morning. And, you know,
well, like,
and then I was thinking.
Yeah, go ahead.
Go ahead. Well, lastly, I think there's a place for that to come back to, like the father's blessing in the movie they talked about a lot. But I think, because I was a teacher for a long time, you talked about this today, so it made me think about it. When the student comes back later and says, you know, I did this and I want to thank you, that's a powerful blessing too, coming upstream. Like, mm-hmm. I think as sons, we need to go to our fathers and say, thank you for what you did, whether it was perfect or not, whether they literally blessed us or not, right. you know, they did their best. And that's a powerful thing.
Well, Ben, you said that. I'm going to tell you what, my dad, you know, like I say, he passed away in 2009 and he had, you know, dementia and Parkinson's. So I could tell my dad, you know, you could see what was going on in his life. Yeah. And I just remember about the last 4 or 5 years, because my older brother took care of my dad the last 13 years of my dad's life. My older brother moved my dad into the house with him and his wife. And my brother was my dad's full time. He took care of my dad. And so, but what I would do whenever I would talk to my dad or see my dad, the last thing I would say to him when we would leave, I'd leave him or get off the phone. I would say, Dad, I love you and thank you.
Yes, amen, amen.
And thank you. And even in his mind, you know, with the dementia, I remember the one time, you know, Dad, I love you, man, and thank you. And he said, Son, I was just trying to help you become a man. And he just, and you yes. know, so yep. I just you're right. I think we need to, I think it's good.
And my I tell dad,
you, I said yeah. that, Bench, and I told my son that, my younger son that, and this is the truth. When we get off the phone, that's what he's, Dad, I love you, man. Thanks a lot. You know, and it means a lot to me to hear him say that.
Right. My dad died of Parkinson's in 2013. And we had some good talks. The last 6 months, it was clear he was going downhill fast. And yes. that was good to have that time. But now, you know, since then, my mom's been alone. I moved her into our house last year. And I knew growing up, I heard the story that her dad was a hard SOB. she never heard those words from her dad. You know, I love you. I'm proud of you. And, you know, I think this was in the movie too. Girls need that too. I'm telling her every night, like she's my kid. I love you. I'm proud of you.
Right.
You know.
Well, I got a daughter. My daughter is 42 years old. She's not married. And she, you know, she has a desire. She wants to be. And, you know, I thank God that she's not desperate and just going out there and wanting to get married for Mary's sake and, you know, having kids and all the other stuff. But I just see there are times I question myself about her. And I said, man, you know, at times, man, did I fail her in some way? Because she has been in a relationship with a guy for the last 14 years that is like, you know, come on now, you know, you're settling, you know, did I fail her? You know, but I continue to do with her because she lives in the Nashville area. It's interesting how God, when we moved back to an area where we could see her every day if we wanted to, but how even at 42 years old, man, how she still wants that affirmation from her dad, you know, I'm proud of her.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. you know, you're yeah. beautiful, you know, just because you're not married, that doesn't make you less of a, you know, affirming her and encouraging her in her walk and in her life, because at times she feels inadequate, you know, incomplete, you know, but even with our daughters, man, that, whew, man. And I tell my sons, and it makes my younger son mad. I said, out of my two kids, she is the strongest. I said, she's strong. Inside, man, she's got something inside of her, a resilience inside of her. My younger son, he jokes about, I said, I don't know why you say that. And I said, well, because she's experienced some things, some disappointments in life that you haven't experienced, and how she's handled a lot of things in her life and how she looks at you, and you have what she wants. You have a family and kids, and that's what she wants. And I'm seeing how she's dealing with that in a positive way. So I said, I told my son, I say that to encourage her. How strong she is, you know. And so, but those daughters, man, they special, you know.
Yeah.
Love my daughter.
Hey, all right. Harvey, can you pray for us? Pray for Sherman and Sherman's wife and family and the whole blessing that God has given us through him.
I will.
Thank you, Pastor.
God in heaven, again, we're grateful for this day, one we've not seen before, but one that will be filled with your presence and your glory. God, and we're grateful that you have tapped us to be a part of your plan to love this world and to see it redeemed. We're grateful for our brother Sherman Smith and his wife Sharon and their family, for how you have used them down through the years, God, to be a credible witness to the gospel of Jesus, sharing their lives in very transparent ways, God, in helping to be a model, if you will, of how we can live and how we can love you, how we can honor you. God, and just thank you for his willingness to kind of share his life through this movie, God, and the way it is being used to touch people all over this nation, if not the world. God, continue to use him as he's sharing, as he's speaking to sports teams and to at churches, et cetera. God, that people might see you as you really are. God, and that's what you aim for each and every one of us, because you have touched us. You have given us an identity. We are your children. We are your ambassadors. We are those that can be that letter that people can read and to see what it means to be in a right relationship with you, your son, Jesus Christ. So help us, we pray, all of us, as we go about this day, may we have eyes to see what it is you may want to do in and through us today. May we have ears to hear what it is you may be saying to us today, God, and may we then use our lives in a way that inspire others to become devoted followers of Jesus. And God, when we slip and we hurt our knees, God, we are grateful for the grace that you give us. So grateful that Sherman said, hey, grace is not a license to sin, but it's an opportunity for us to witness your goodness and your kindness. So be with us, we pray this day. And it's in your son's strong name that we offer it to you. Amen and
amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
All right, God bless you.
God bless you, guys.